the guitar is probably the first instrument that I learned, so we'll start with that one. There's a tune that developed in the early 60s from me hearing Ali Akbar Khan and Ravi Shankar play, and I was looking for a way of kind of getting that feel on the guitar, so I tuned it to tonics and fifths, and this is called Blend. Growing up in New York part of the time, too, my mom, as a musician, played the harp. I used to travel with her around the South. She'd play concert tours, and she was definitely very eclectic. She played Bach to Boogie Woogie, Scarlatti, Rodgers and Hammerstein, all the Strauss waltzes, just about anything you could think of she played, and that was course a big influence. I had no real desire to play the harp, but I certainly had a good choice of music to accept or reject.
I used to see him weekends. He was just marvelous company. I didn't see him as much as I wanted to, but oh goodness, it's so long ago, I can hardly remember what happened. But he was such good company. And
what was he like during that period of his life?
Well, he was always good company.
I know, but when...
And he's very, very talkative, much more talkative than I. He knows how to express himself. And he was just a genius at expressing himself and wonderful musician. Oh, there is another picture taken with Digger. It was my adopted son from Ireland. It's a little crooked there. That's the only picture I have of Sandy without his glasses on.
Boston when he was a music student and I was an art student. At the time he was playing, what was unique about Sandy, you know, as opposed to all the other folk banjo pickers around, was the fact that he was playing Bach on the banjo. He was the first guy that I ever saw that was playing like classical. He playing Jesu, Joy of Man's Desiring on the banjo, on the five-string banjo. Had an old Pete Seeger lengthened neck kind of model. And he'd been taking lessons with Eric Darling. But in any case, he wasn't playing straight folk music. He was playing more sophisticated kind of music with folk tools, you know. And he also was a guy who took me to see Ravi Shankar's first United States concert. Mm-hmm. It was at Carnegie Hall. I can't remember the year, but we sat in the front row. I sat next to Miles Davis, I remember that. And it was like, you know, Sandy was kind of ahead of the curve as far as like, he just was really smart, really intelligent in his musical choices. I mean, he was like, you know, also aware of like the blues and bluegrass and stuff, but he was pretty eclectic about his choices of musical influence.
All that stuff just kind of I just like to see the similarities in the music of the world and how they all really weren't that different.
Sandy came through the door of the Gaslight Cafe on McDougal Street on the cusp of the 60s, the very headwaters of the 60s. And he was a poem of light with just this amazing talent for all us fellow travelers on this amazing path of convergence of all these amazing talented people coming together. And when Sandy came in, I think the first thing I heard him do was play Bach on the banjo, and my jaw hit the floor. And every time I've heard Sandy play anything, my jaw goes immediately to that same spot on the floor, because he is such a marriage of human and instrument that you can't tell where one leaves off and the other begins.
Something that Sandy was particularly into, however, that wasn't his bag at all. He had enough blues of his own, he didn't need to play them. But no, it's interesting because his music was really more rooted in traditional folk music and in bluegrass music and in classical music, you know. And that was also very interesting, because I don't know who before Sandy played classical music with electric instruments. I mean, maybe somebody did, but I don't know who it was, you know. So I mean, he really had a wonderful touch for classical music, and I guess he could have just, didn't he start out to become a classical player? And wasn't that the whole idea? Yeah. And somewhere along the line, like a lot of us in the 60s, he got waylaid and wandered off to a whole other area.
I want to introduce my first guest tonight, who has been one of my musical heroes for a long, long time, and I'm very, very excited by the fact that he's here. This man performed the Carmina Burana, which is Carl Orff's incredible piece of music, on the banjo, and he plays just about every other instrument you can imagine. So let's have a warm welcome for Sandy Bull. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much for being here, man. What, Sandy, what's that instrument?
That's called an oud.
And where's it from?
It's from Turkey.
This is a Turkish oud, huh?
Yes.
And, you know, I thought I saw a camel walking in. What was that you just played on then?
That was this improvised.
You've been writing pieces like that for a long time, right?
Yeah, I've been playing them. I don't really write them down.
You just, are they different every single time you play them?
Hopefully.
And Mendy's music, he played only one piece of Om Kulthum. And then he played other pieces, you know, like ta 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 ra 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 ra, you know, Orfeo Negro.
Or, yeah, Orfeo Negro.
And
Manhattan kind of.
Yeah, and he played American folk music on the wood. He made his own improvisation, based still on Middle Eastern scales. But actually, he didn't study Middle Eastern music. He studied the oud.
Awards, which I produced for Mix Magazine, we had a brief recognition of Sandy in which I called him, you know, one of the true pioneers of world music before there was such a term as world music, and it's absolutely true. And I mean, he never met an interesting sound that he didn't like, you know, and he was open to and loved to experiment with any kind of sound on the instruments that he knew and on instruments that he didn't know, and the really amazing thing was how he transcended with his playing the conventional idea of what those instruments were supposed to sound like. Particularly the electric oud, which I just, to this day, you know, I mean, I'll sit around and listen to Sandy's recordings of on his oud. You know, a really great example of what I was talking about is his version of Manhattan de Carnaval, which is obviously one of his classics, but where he's playing, you know, bossa nova music on this, you know, Middle Eastern, electrified Middle Eastern instrument, you know, and you know, that somebody would think to do that, you know, was really amazing.
Well, when I first met Sandy, he was playing pretty much straight ahead acoustic folk music. And of course, you know, when the Beatles happened, you know, that gave everybody permission to elect the electric. And Sandy fell in love with Pop Staples' style of guitar picking, you know, with a heavy-duty reverb. And he learned to use the reverb box and the wah-wah pedal and the volume pedals. And he started to, you know, then he started to go on out. You know, he started to really get out of there. And then he fell in love with Chuck Berry. He fell in love with Memphis. And once that happened, it was all over.
important to understand Sandy Bull's music was a big part of the transition from top 40 music to underground rock. It was in that netherworld between folk and the new rock. And you could hear it all the time on the radio in San Francisco during the period of time that the radio was in that transition. And it was KMPX, and it was on at 11 o'clock at night, and it ran till 6 in the morning, and then foreign language broadcasting took over. And they played what little new rock was out at the time. This would be 1966, and they played mixture of hip folk music, because folk music and this new rock were very much alive. So Buffy St. Marie, you can hear some of her songs, especially Codeine, because it was a drug song. Dave Van Ronk, very Jim Queskin jug band, little pieces of the folk world, and certainly Sandy Bull was a staple in their diet of folk music on KMPX. You heard that stuff all the time. 2 a.m, on would come Memphis. You know, floating out of the radio like a beam from the ether. It was phenomenal.
Actually, it wasn't called that. It was called nothing. It was at, a club on Minetta Lane called the Fat Black Pussycat Cafe and Theater. And I put together a little review called Moondog, Me, and Tiny Tim. And people went crazy. It was like past, present, and future, all in one insane travelogue. And Moondog began to be upset about what I was saying about the government and the president, and he also thought Tiny Tim was a sissy, so he quit. Moondog was a blind Viking who dressed in triangular leather and drank Poland water and wrote ballets and played drums made out of triangles. It was amazing. But what to do? I mean, Sandy was the only person that could possibly, with his amazing music, in front of this huge tie-dye, when nobody ever saw a tie-dye, that was put together by a mad artist named Bill Heine, and it had, like, spells cast on it, and he played the flute as the dye. It was like underwater. And we lit it from behind. Sandy really liked playing in front of that tie-dye, and he could kind of disappear into the tie-dye, and the music would like float out.
I don't think Sandy really gave much of a shit what anybody thought about his performances.
I don't think he did that.
He never did. It used to take forever to tune between songs on stage. You wonder why people would go out for a drink. If you take 11 minutes to tune between songs, people tend to get restless. There was a period of time when Sandy was like George Jones. I mean, he sort of like, maybe he would show up and he wouldn't. If he felt like playing, he would show up.
Yeah. If the sound was good.
If the sound was good. The sound could never be good for Sandy. You know, the sound was never good enough for Sandy. And no one else was ever in tune.
I heard more from Sandy about what his performances had been like in the 60s than I actually witnessed, you know, because in later years he would tell stories about it, you know, and how he drove everyone crazy and, you know, with endless tuning and you know, when he wasn't in the best of shape, shall we say. And I never saw any of that. And frankly, I'm just as glad that I didn't, rather, you know.
And Sandy never kind of came off as some, you know, big shot, like, you know, legend or anything. He just was a guy moving to town with his kids, you know. And then over time, I'd hear little things or I'd run across something. Like one day, I remember my son Dustin called me up, and he'd been reading Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. And he called me up and he said, "Dad, I need to read you something." And I said, "Okay." And he read me that passage about where Hunter Thompson said something about, you know, leaning back with Sandy Bull Saigon shades on. And Dustin said, "Is that just a weird coincidence, or is that like our Sandy?" And I said, "Well, I'm pretty sure that it's our Sandy." So I hung up and I called Sandy up and I told him about it. And he said, "Oh yeah," and just kind of casually told me some of the most hair-raising Hunter Thompson stories I've ever heard in my life about the three of them, him and Dan Winter and Hunter. And then I remember there's a book, some sort of a biography on the Beatles. Maybe it's a John Lennon book or a Paul McCartney book. Paul McCartney book, I think. And that apparently he's the guy in Come Together. You know that? You know that story?
No.
"He shoots Coca-Cola," that line. "He shoots Coca-Cola." Apparently that's Sandy.
So I was laying out by the pool and suddenly he burst from the house and started shooting this 45 caliber pistol and splashing water on me. Took a machine gun, took a semi-automatic machine gun, filed it down and made it fully automatic, and then went hunting wild turkeys. Somehow got a hold of some tracer ammunition and set fire to the prairie. It's unbelievable.
Did you go on that?
Maniac. What a very nice man. Liked animals, he did. Dr. Benway. Always diagnosing himself. Always diagnosing himself with his medical degree and then prescribing the appropriate medicine.
This is an instrument that really inspired a lot of the work that I did on guitar before I got a hold of one of these instruments. This is the Sarod from North India. And Ali Akbar Khan is a master of the Sarod, and I had a chance to be around his music school up in the early 60s up in Berkeley and the Bay Area in general. It was kind of a floating music school. It was in various locations in various years up there. And I didn't really get to attend the school seriously until about 1976, but I was always aware of it and used to drop in occasionally. Ali Akbar Khan actually sent me my first Sarod in 1964, very kindly, from India.
Sandy Bull, in many ways, he was a peripheral figure because he didn't do any of those things that would have made him a big star in the sort of Greenwich Village folk music world, you know, i.e. sing and write his own songs and have some kind of matinee idol personality to project in, as a Dylan or a Phil Oakes did. And that was essentially the realm that he was operating in while he was recording those albums for Vanguard. He was operating essentially as a kind of iconoclast experimentationalist, a person who was running these experiments with a guitar to try and move the boundaries around and find new ways of using that instrument in the context of what had been known as folk music. Now, there was a lot of people doing those kinds of experiments in pop music at the time, and there was a lot of barriers being moved around. But it was always by artists who were on the periphery, and once they moved the boundaries, then the mainstream artists would come thundering through. Sandy Bull was one of those guys who operated on the peripheries, and he was never going to be part of that mainstream. His experiments were too iconoclastic, too individualistic. His pursuits were too... I don't want to say narrow, but they were pointed in a direction that he saw. It was a vision of his. It wasn't a vision of a marketplace. It was a vision of a guitar and the way a guitar could work.
You know, the fact that he could experiment so much and the fact that he could do it so, come out of it with something so intriguing and so listenable and so, you know, enrapturing. Whatever adjectives you want to throw at it, was just a real gift, and you know, I think that, you know, for all the difficulties that Sandy had, he had a really wonderful life, and if I have any regret, it's only that, you know, millions more people never got to hear, you know, experience Sandy's music, and it's so few people know really what his contributions were.
In my opinion, Sandy was ahead of his time by listening to his, at least to listen to his Invention album and Blend Peace, especially that he have South American jazz, blues, American folk, Egyptian, Kulsoom music, all together at once in one piece. Nobody did that before. All of them, they are new. And that was the mastership of Sandy. But because really he was ahead of his time, people didn't notice what he's doing. But who noticed it? He was their hero. he deal with every note in the chord, as though each note itself is the important note in the piece, not the chord. They say the best words are the little ones which will mean a lot. So I will not talk too much to take the length of the short film. No matter how long it is short to talk about a friend like Sandy.
We lost track of each other for a while, and then we ran into your dad. He had gone through a really rough patch of substance and stuff, and came out the other side shining and beautiful, and we appeared in Berkeley at a place called the Freight and Salvage together and had a wonderful time. And that's when he had all this stuff, all this great electrical stuff, and Billy Higgins, oh yeah. Then the next time we ran into each other, it was just him and his oud in Texas, and I was doing a show called Cowboys for Indians at Maynard Downs, the finest quarter horse racetrack in the state of Texas, and he just appeared off a runway or something and said, hey, can I play? So I think I have to, that was my last remembrance. We've talked on the phone, we talked about getting together again. He didn't want to do it with Tiny, it broke my heart. He thought Tiny, it would make it too much of a freak show. So I found somebody else about a year ago named Baby Gramps that would have certainly done it, another Phantom Cabaret, and it broke my heart. When, because, you know, you like to, when you have something come through the muse, you like to see it turn into substance and something. But somewhere in the stars, we'll all come together. I love you, Sandy. Thanks.
You know, that's a wonderful picture. I don't remember who took that. That was before you were born.
Beyond the playing, fantastic playing, it was, and really even beyond the ideas that he had, it was the personality and the soul behind the ideas that I always found most fascinating about Sandy. because not very many people would ever have thought of it and then carried through in such a fearless way.